Oh, I didn't see you there. Hello, friends. Welcome to another edition of Our Nation, presented by DSull's Army. Today, we'll be discussing the polarizing figure, Richard Nixon, the 37th president of the United States and the only president to resign in office. We'll be discussing his personal life, and that's a doozy, his election, his foreign and his domestic policy, all the way up to his eventual checkmate in the scandal of Watergate. Now, let's first dive into his personal life, and I hope you enjoy this adventure of Richard Nixon, the truth about Dick.
Our story starts with a poor Quaker boy in Yorba, California. He grew up in extreme poverty, and his ranch foreclosed, and he had to move to Whittier, California. He was a smart boy, and eventually went to Duke. While he was in Duke, he graduated top of his class, which earned himself a spot in the FBI. Sadly, due to budget cuts, he was rejected, and he had to find a new job in the Navy during World War II. Although he never served in combat in the Navy, he got two medals of recognition and advanced two ways up into Lieutenant Colonel. He rose to national attention when he gained congressman in the district in California, and then quickly rose to senator 2 years later in 1950. This parlayed himself to the vice president under Eisenhower in 1952.
Oh, sorry guys. Now that we've learned a little bit about Richard Nixon's early life, let's move into his first presidential election in 1968. We're going to have Justin's investigative unit taking us through this story and interesting interviews from the lesser-known Johnson & Johnson triplet.
Hello, and welcome to Justin's investigative report. Today we will be interviewing political aide Micah Johnson, the lesser-known of the Johnson & Johnson triplets. Let's go.
Oh no, he's sleeping.
Yodale! Hey, woo!
Shabbat shalom!
Shalom to you, kind sir. Would you like some milk?
Oh, of course. Thank you
and
so much.
Here is a flower to top it all off.
Just delicious.
I'm glad
milk.
You enjoyed. And you're an avid Nixon fan, aren't you?
I am an avid Nixon fan, and that avidness goes back to the 1960 election, where he lost to JFK simply because JFK just looks so goddamn good on that telly.
What a shame. Now, my first question to you is, what was the social problems that were around the time that Nixon was getting elected?
So I would say there were three main social problems during the time period. One, the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr., which was obviously the renowned civil rights activist for the blacks. Another is the assassination of Bobby Kennedy during the time period. And Bobby Kennedy was renowned for his work in California, of course, civil rights, social rights. And then the third was the polarizing Vietnam War. And now Vietnam War, a lot of people disagreed on. And so Nixon kind of set them straight with his platforms.
All right. And what were these platforms you're talking about, and how did that affect the election?
So specifically on the Vietnam platform, he actually opted. He said, we're going to pull the troops out. And this actually became a big rallying cry for the U.S. A lot of people liked that policy. The other policy that he instituted as far as the social and civil rights policies go was the introduction of this Philadelphia plan. This Philadelphia plan set a quota for these big businesses in order to have them hire more minorities like blacks, Jews, etc.
And finally, you're doing a great job, by the way.
I'm sweating like a spilkus on TV.
Thank you, kind sir. My third question is, what other people were he going up against in this election?
So he actually had two competitors, unlike most other presidents who only have one. And Nixon, of course, the Republican candidate. Hubert Humphreys was the Democratic candidate during the time and actually carried most of the Northeast. And the third candidate, an independent candidate, Gerald Wallace, hailing from Alabama, who carried most of the southern deep south states.
Oh, wow, that was great. Thank you for your time.
Oh, Shabbat shalom.
Nixon also won the 1972 election with the fourth largest popular vote margin win in the history of the presidential elections.
We find ourselves rich in goods, but ragged in spirit, reaching with magnificent precision for the moon, but failing in ruckus discord on earth. We are caught in war, wanting peace. We are torn in division, wanting unity. We see around us empty lives, wanting fulfillment. We see tasks that not doing, waiting for hands to do them.
Oh, sorry guys. Now that we talked about that wild election, let's move into foreign policy and how Richard Nixon attempted to weave together the free and communist nations in mutual trade and peace. We'll talk about his relationship in Southeast Asia and also his run-in with OPEC. Let's move on.
Hello, and welcome to the second edition of Justin's Investigative Report. We are here at the White House, in the bathroom, if you may ask, for what we believe is William P. Rogers, former secretary for Nixon, taking a bath. Terry Ho. Hello, William P. Rogers, how are you doing? Do you need a towel,
oh,
sir?
Yes, please.
You also look like a man who could use some Maxim moisture cream body wash.
Soft. Thank you. Thank you. It's very tender of you.
Now, my first question for you today is, how did Nixon connect with the communist powers of China and Russia?
Now, Nixon, before his presidency, was known as a Red Hunter, so it was very strange when he was the first president to travel to communist China. Now, in China, he did a tremendous, great feat for connecting communist China and Russia, really easing tensions and helping trade agreements. And with the Soviet Union, he instituted SALT, which was the Special Arms Limitation Treaty, and entered a time of detente, where really arms were decreased and tension between the nuclear powers really was not as high as it were in the Cold War heights.
Wow, thank you very much. And a little controversial subject, how did Nixon handle the Vietnam issue?
Well, see, Nixon instituted the Nixon Doctrine, which basically said that we will support people fighting against communists with military aid and money, but not with troops. So with that, he applied it to Vietnam, and he decided to pull troops out of Vietnam. But, I mean, that situation gets messy, and we really don't have time to talk about that now.
Thank you so much, and you can go back to finishing your bathe.
Thank you. Do you feel how soft those hands are?
It's very soft.
The OPEC oil crisis began in 1973, when President Nixon sent military aid to Israel, who was fighting against Syria and Egypt. OPEC responded with an oil embargo against the U.S. and other European countries. By the time it was lifted, oil prices had risen drastically. Time magazine called it the most serious economic threat to face the nation since the Great Depression, as people were worried about oil and simply topping off their cars in order to ensure that they would have oil for the next day's drive. It was predicted to be a 35% drop in energy.
I literally just sat in line for 2 hours just waiting to top it off. Jesus Christ.
It's been a day and a life barely moved. I'm hungry. I'm thirsty.
This past year saw far-reaching results from our new policies for peace. By continuing to revitalize our friendships and by our missions to Beijing and to Moscow, we were able to establish the base for a new and more durable pattern of relationships among the nations of the world. Because of America's bold initiatives, 1972 will be long remembered as the year of the greatest progress since the end of World War II toward a lasting peace in the world.
Right, don't forget the three! Left, right, oh wow! Oh, sorry guys! Oh, that was embarrassing. From foreign policy, let's go talk about domestic policy now. Now, Richard Nixon was a big proponent of policies like social welfare, and he wanted to protect the environment. Now, in this section, we're going to hear from his inaugural address, and also another edition of Justin's Investigative Unit.
Hello, and welcome to the third installment of Justin's Investigative Report. We are here in beautiful Perry, Texas, where we have finally tracked down Spiro Agnew, former vice president under Nixon, as well as known tax evader. Follow me and we'll ask him some questions. Hello, Mr. Spiro, can I ask you a few questions? I have some Sprite for you.
You know I'm in the middle of a workout.
I know, but this is important.
Look at this body. Do you think I can take performance-enhancing drinks? No.
I'm sorry. Well, my first question for you, Mr. Spiro, is what sort of bills did Nixon pass for equality while you were in office?
You know I'm in the middle of a workout, right? For women, he passed Title IX, which guaranteed equality in both the classroom and on the sports field. And for Native Americans, he ended this assimilation culture of America and kind of gave them back some reservation lands.
On top of that, what sort of laws did he pass for the environment? You're doing great.
He started this clean air initiative and clean water initiative. Guy hated pollution. In addition, he also created this Environmental Protection Agency, which basically helped keep America cleaner.
Oh, good for him. And lastly, what sort of laws did he...
Am I almost done yet?
This is the last one. The last one is, what sort of laws did he do to change the voting techniques that we use today?
He was an enthusiastic supporter of Amendment 26, which basically gave 18-year-olds the right to vote. It was always 21 before. After that, became 18-year-olds and above were allowed to vote.
Thank you so much.
So many prom pictures. One, two, I'm just gonna hold on to this one. Now we're gonna go to President Nixon's greatest folly, the Watergate scandal. Now here, he bugged the Democratic leader at the Watergate Hotel, lied to the courts, and then was trapped by his own recordings of telling his political advisors he's doing this. That's one tricky dick. Let's go watch a segment, boys.
all of my years of public life, I have never obstructed justice. And I think, too, that I can say that in my years of public life, that I welcome this kind of examination, because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook. I've earned everything I've got. In the past few days, however, it has become evident to me that I no longer have a strong enough political base in the Congress to justify continuing that effort.
Hey, thanks for joining us again, folks, as we went through the crazy life of Richard Nixon, his rollercoaster of presidency from a high to the treaty with the USSR and China to his eventual downfall at the Watergate scandal. The life of Richard Nixon is one incredibly interesting and intricate one. Thanks for joining us, folks.